quite some time, the rabbis of this congregation have preached about the dangers of filter bubbles, echo chambers, and groupthink, a term first explored by psychologist Irving Janis in the early 1970s. Janis described groupthink as the mode of thinking in which individual members of small cohesive groups tend to accept a viewpoint or a conclusion that represents a perceived group consensus. Whether or not the group members believe it to be valid, or correct, or optimal. It seems we would prefer the echo chamber of the continual feedback loop of like opinions to the countenancing of opposing views. These invisible bubbles we create for ourselves with the media we consume, the friends we choose, and the groups with which we affiliate are safe, efficient, and effective, or so we tell ourselves. In reality, however, clinging to that which only reinforces our particular worldview only forces us further inward, isolating within the echo chamber we create, shutting ourselves off from those who see the world differently, and striving only to affirm that which we are so sure is true. We rob ourselves of the opportunity for intellectual, emotional, and yes, even spiritual growth. I was saddened in recent days to see two examples of this type of behavior. The first example was the reaction to the executive order that President Trump issued on December 11th. An action the Anti-Defamation League called an important step, acknowledging the growing concern about anti-Semitism on American college campuses. According to a press release by the ADL, including Jews in Title VI protections is something the ADL and previous administrations have supported for years. The press release went on to say that the action actually represents a step forward for our country. However, stoked by claims the executive order would define Judaism as a nationality and not just a religion, intense argument erupted. Even before the text of the executive order was made public for us to read. One blogger observed countless celebrities and commentators claimed that this was an attempt to define Jews as un-American and suggested that it was the first step towards deportation and, God forbid, a Holocaust. I know my personal Facebook feed lit up with fiery exchanges among friends, all before anyone was able to read the order. Before anyone could verify the validity of such grave claims. But what upset me most is once again, anti-Semitism is being politicized and used as a tool to keep us fearful and divided in our preferred political camps. And we are no closer to eradicating hate from our world. I was saddened, too, this week to follow the contentious impeachment hearings in the House of Representatives. As predicted, both sides repeated their own familiar talking points until time expired. And as predicted, all but three of the 435 representatives voted along party lines. Surely, this was a monumental moment in U.S. history. But in the end, when the dust settled, everyone was exactly where they began, steadfast in their respective camps. There is one thing about which both Democrats and Republicans seem to agree. Whether you argue the president committed grave crimes worthy of impeachment, or that the president is the victim of a premeditated attack by those still reeling from the 2016 election, everyone agrees these are dark times. Regardless of who you voted for in 2016, regardless of who you will vote for next year, we all admit that we cannot continue forward like this. But how can we ever emerge from such darkness? It's hard to imagine at this point. So perhaps the upcoming holiday of Hanukkah offers a path forward. The word Hanukkah means dedication, named for when the Maccabees rededicated the temple after their battle with the mighty King Antiochus in a ceremony lasting 8 days. By returning to and reclaiming the temple, the Maccabees recommitted themselves to a Jewish way of life, to all that they held dear. The real miracle of Hanukkah was that the Maccabees took the chance, a risk, a leap of faith, to return to the temple and recommit to the Judaism they fought to defend. They took the first step even though they were not sure they had the resources to succeed. It's the miracle of human courage that empowers us to take risks for the future, even in our imperfect, uncertain world. It's the courage, even in the darkest of times, to create our own light. That indeed is our obligation this holiday, to share the light of Hanukkah with the world. We're actually prohibited from using the Hanukkah lights for our own personal use. Hanukkah lights are not for studying, they're not for cooking, they're not even meant for our own enjoyment. Rather, we're instructed to light the menorah in the window for the sole purpose of Pirsum HaNes, to publicize the great miracle that the candles represent for all passersby. That symbol must not be lost on us this week. Here in the darkest days of winter, perhaps some of the darkest days in U.S. history, I pray that we can each muster the courage of Judah Maccabee to take a risk for our future. Regardless how anyone else reacts, elected officials, television pundits, trusted friends, even our own family, each of us must say enough is enough with the vitriol and the self-righteousness. Disagreement and differences of opinion are healthy. In fact, Jewish tradition encourages dialogue and debate. But there is a way to argue facts, not rhetoric, with decorum. We must model that for others and pray that our behavior catches. I'll conclude with a story from our tradition. I've offered it before, but I feel compelled to tell it again here tonight. A rabbi once asked his students, "How do we know when the night has ended and the day has begun?" Their first student answered, "When I look at the fields and I can distinguish between my field and the field of my neighbor, that's when I know the night has ended and the day has begun." Another responded, "When I see a house and I can tell that it's my house and not the house of my neighbor, that's when I know the night has ended and the day has begun." A third student said, "When I see a flower, and I can make out the colors of the flower, whether they are red or yellow or blue, that's when I know the night has ended and the day has begun." Each answer brought a sadder frown to the rabbi's face. "None of you understand. You only divide. You divide your house from the house of your neighbor, your field from the field of your neighbor. You separate one color from all of the others. Is that all we can do? Dividing, separating, splitting the world into pieces? Isn't the world broken enough? Students asked the rabbi, "So Rabbi, how do we know that the night has ended and the day has begun?" The rabbi stared back into the faces of his students, and with a voice suddenly gentle and imploring, he said, "When you look into the face of the person who is before you, and you can tell that that person is your brother or your sister, that is when we know the night has ended and the day has begun." Just as the lights of the Chanukiah will illuminate these darkest days of winter, so too can we emerge from the dark period of division in our country. Our sages taught, just as this day commences in darkness, the darkness later giving way to light, so the darkness that you find yourself in will be replaced with bright light. We must open our eyes and see the light is reflected in each one of us. The divine spark is embedded in each of us. When we break down the stiff walls of the political silos that we create for ourselves and open our hearts to that which unites us, we can mend the fractures in our society, and we will emerge stronger. Together, then, we can stand ready to welcome the arrival of the bright light of empathy and connectedness, knowing that it illuminates each of our faces, making tangible the divine echad, the oneness that is at the heart of the world.